सो गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी विल स्टार्ट द चैप्टर नंबर 2 फ्रॉम आवर बुक हॉर्नबिल। चैप्टर नेम इज वी आर नॉट अफ्रेड टू डाई इफ वी कैन ऑल बी टुगेदर। द चैप्टर इज रिटन बाय गॉर्डन कुक एंड एलन ईस्ट। सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल वी विल डिस्कस द इंट्रोडक्शन एंड समरी पार्ट ऑफ दिस चैप्टर। सो नाउ लिसन केयरफुली। दिस चैप्टर सिग्निफाइज द मीनिंग ऑफ दिस टाइटल। It is a fact that if people can together they can face any kind of danger. It is interesting to read how the family of the narrator duplicates the round the world voice successfully. Yani ye kahani hame batayegi ki is kahani ka jo narrator hai varnan karta hai wo kis tarah se pure sansar ki samundri yatra kar leta hai safaltapurvak। किस तरह से उसके जो परिवार के जो लोग होते हैं, परिवार के जो सदस्य होते हैं, वो उसका परेशानियों में किस तरह से साथ निभाते हैं और किस तरह से वो उसकी सांसारिक यात्रा को पूरा करवा पाते हैं। सो वी विल रीड द एक्सप्लेनेशन ऑफ दिस स्टेटमेंट इन द होल स्टोरी एंड नाउ वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट द समरी पार्ट ऑफ द चैप्टर नंबर 2। सो इज़ अ 37 ईयर ओल्ड बिजनेसमैन and his family had dreamed of sailing in the wake of the famous explorer Captain James Cook and for past 16 years and the members of the family had spent all their leisure time honing their seafaring skills in British waters. The narrator, his wife Mary, his son Jonathan who was 6 years old and daughter Suzanne who was 7 years old set sail from Plymouth, England to duplicate the round the world voyage earlier made by Captain James Cook. The first leg of the 105,000 kilometer spanning over 3 years presently from the west coast of Africa to Cape Town. They took 2 crewmen with them that were American Larry Wiesel and Swiss Herb Sagler to tackle the roughest sea, the Southern Indian Ocean. On the second day out of the Cape Town, they faced strong gales and waves began to rise high. Their size up to 15 meters alarmed them. They were at east of Cape Town on December 25, 3500 kilometers away. Despite bad weather, they celebrated Christmas and New Year's Day. Saw no improvement in weather and changed it from bad to the worse. Then at dawn on January 2, the waves were very huge. As ships were rose to the top of each wave, they could see endless enormous seas rolling towards them. They dropped the storm jib to slow the boat down. Then they double-lashed everything and went through their lift life raft drill, put on oilskins and life jackets and waited for the worst. Then the first indication of coming disaster came at about 6 p.m. The wind dropped and the sky got dark. A huge wave like a cloud over the ship came over the ship. The roar became a thunder as it struck the ship. The deck shook. A torrent of seawater broke over the ship. The narrator had smashed onto the wheel. He accepted the approaching death and started losing consciousness. Then the narrator had rose out of the water. He saw wave walker capsizing. Then a huge wave turned up her upright. The narrator caught the guardrails. Wave tossed him. His ribs cracked and his mouth was full of blood and broken teeth. The water was everywhere, but he did not leave the wheel to investigate. Suddenly, the front hatch has thrown open and Mary appeared. She cried that they were drowning. Larry and Herb were pumping like madmen. The broken things lay scattered here and there. The narrator swam to the children's cabin and asked if they were all right. They said they were, though Sue had a bump above her eyes. The narrator too had a hammer, screw and canvas. They put canvas over the gaping holes and some water was deflected. The debris had started to block the hand pumps. The electric pump has stopped working. The narrator worked with the help of another hand pump. They were not getting any replies to their mayday calls. On January 3, the water level had come under control. The boat's main rib frames nearly broken down. They had survived for 15 hours since the waves hit. Then the narrator, the charts and found there were two small islands a few hundred kilometers to the east. Then the boat wouldn't take them to Australia in the broken condition. One island was the Amsterdam. On January 4, after 36 hours of continuous pumping, they had drained out of the water. Now they were heading for Lie Amsterdam Island. They ate their first meal in almost 2 days with corned beef and cracker biscuits, but their respite was short-lived. At 4 p.m., black clouds began building up behind them. Within the hour, the wind was back to 40 knots and the sea were getting higher. The weather conditioned to deteriorate throughout the night, and by dawn on January 5, their situation was again desperate. The narrator went in to comfort the children. John asked if they were dying. He assured them that they would make out, but John added that they were not afraid of dying if they could be all together. The narrator took every care to protect the undamaged part of the hull with heavy nylon rope and plastic barrels of paraffin. Then Wave Walker rowed out to the storm by morning of January 6. The narrator tried to get a reading on the sextant. He found that they were somewhere looking for 65 wide island. When he was thinking, Sue came to him with a card she had made which had caricatures of the narrator and made him laugh. She had written message inside. It was, "How I love you both." The narrator checked and rechecked the calculations. They had lost their main compass. He had been using the spare one. But all about 2 p.m. he went on the deck and asked Larry to steer a course of 185 degrees. He expected to see the island at about 5 p.m. Then he went below a heavy heart and dozed off till 6 p.m. The narrator woke up. Jonathan came and asked if he could have a hug. He asked the reason, and Jonathan added that he was the best daddy and the best captain in the whole world. Sue added that he was, as he had found the island, it was in front of them. So he rushed on the deck and looked out the outline. The Amsterdam, it was only a bleak piece of volcanic rock with a little vegetation. It was most beautiful island in the world. All the 28 inhabitants of the island welcomed and cheered them as they landed on the shore. With the land under his feet again, the narrator thought of his crewmen Harry and Herbig, who were optimistic under the stress and fought with the odds successfully. He also thought of Mary, who fought with courage and did not lose hope. He also thought of Sue with a head injury and Jonathan, who was not afraid to die. So this was the complete introduction and summary part of the chapter. The text part of the chapter we will continue in the next class. Till then, thank you very much.